Hello. That was funny, apparently. That's nice of you. I am from Australia originally. I've been here so long, I was just saying that I've had to change the way I speak so that people understand me. Because you can only put up with people saying, I'm sorry, what? When you say, g'day, matey. So now I perhaps sound a little more British. My name is Matt Fradd. I met a woman better looking than my country. She was American, so I moved here. And for the last several years, I have been traveling around the country and internationally, speaking and writing exclusively on pornography. It's my job. My mum's really proud of me. I know that she lies to people when they ask what her eldest is doing for a living. I know because my brother told me. Friends will come over and they'll have tea with her, you know, and they'll talk about their son's a lawyer. What does your son do? This is what she says. He helps people. Oh, how does he help them? It doesn't matter. Just leave it alone. I'm so honored to be here and I'm so thankful. This is certainly not a religious conference. There are people here who are LDS and Catholic and I'm sure atheist, agnostic, Jewish. But I know there are a lot of you in here who are LDS. And as a Catholic, I just want to say I'm tremendously impressed by your creativity and energy. Some of my pro-love, anti-porn heroes, they're all Mormon, so I don't know how you do it without coffee. I can't love my children without coffee. So. Thank you to Vorna and all those who have brought me here. In this talk, I would like to talk about the essential reason pornography is wrong. Now, no one talk can cover all of the different facets, all of the things that need to be said, and I'm not going to attempt that. Instead, I'd like to focus on this one issue. Is pornography intrinsically bad, or is it just bad because of the consequences that result from it? And I'm going to be arguing for the former. A lot of what I'm going to be talking about comes from this book, and I beg you to get it. Karol Wojtyła is his name. Then he became St. John Paul II. But one doesn't need to be a Catholic to appreciate what this A-grade philosopher has to say about the dignity of the human person and what love is. So the book is called Love and Responsibility, and I'll be drawing from that. Hugh Hefner famously said of Alfred Kinsey, if he is the prophet, I am his pamphleteer. Well, I think that Karol Wojtyła was the prophet, and I'm happy to be his pamphleteer. Well, before we begin and addressing why pornography is wrong, it'll be important to address why pornography isn't wrong. Pornography's not wrong, and I know you know this, but it's important that we begin with it anyway. Pornography's not wrong because sex is bad, or somehow not good. It's not bad because sexual desire isn't holy, and it's not bad because the body is shameful. Let's take them one at a time. Sex is good. If it wasn't good, you couldn't pervert it. If it wasn't beautiful, you couldn't make it ugly. You can't make mud ugly. Nor is the problem that pornography causes us to think about sex too much. Quite the contrary, I think a pornified culture has forgotten how to think about sex. We dream about sex, we drool over sex, we watch sex. But these are very different activities to thinking about sex. If we thought about sex, we might say, well, what is it? What's its nature? What's its purpose? Is it sacred? Whose idea was it? It seems like some of our culture are under the impression that it was invented by 50 Shades of Stupid. Cosmo, no? Now, as a Christian, I think it was God's idea. In fact, the very first commandment in the Bible from God to humanity is Genesis chapter 1, verse 28. Look at that, I'm a Catholic who knows the scripture verse. Genesis chapter 1, verse 28. God says, be fruitful and multiply. By that, he did not mean grow pineapples and invent calculators. If that's what your translation says, throw it out and get a new one. All right, so sex is good. Sexual desire is good. It is not synonymous with lust. Sexual desire propels, as it were, one to make a gift of himself or herself according to the demands of chastity. And lust does the opposite. Lust compels us to take. So sexual desire, in the proper context and with the proper motivation, would say, this is my body given up for you. Whereas lust would say exactly the opposite. This is your body taken by me. You know, if you're sitting here today and you think, well, look, I've prayed quite a lot and I no longer experience sexual desire, that's not a sign that you're holy. It's a sign that you're dead. Sexual desire is good. Sex is good. And the body is good. The naked body is good. If it weren't, you couldn't degrade it. When we say you degraded him, you're presupposing that him had a grade to begin with. You can't degrade washing machines and paper clips. Right. The human body is the outward expression of a profound mystery, that of the human person. What are some reasons people give for thinking that pornography is wrong? Well, we might say something like, well, it's addictive, you know. It propagates racial stereotypes. Much of the porn out there today is violent or misogynistic. It leads to marital breakdown. Young people are being exposed to it. You could give me a list as long as your arm like this. But here's the thing. Is this why pornography is essentially wrong, or are these sort of the consequences of pornography? It seems to me that it's the consequences of pornography. Or in regard to the violence and misogyny, we could say, well, that's not essential to what pornography is. So here's my point. It's very important that we educate people about what pornography is doing to them, neurologically, you know, how it affects us sociologically and so forth. Very, very important. I just wrote a whole book about it. But theoretically, we could change some of these, or all of them. Like, if the only problem with porn is that it's addictive, then we should help people regulate their porn use, like we do with gambling or drinking. And if they can't regulate it, if they can't use it appropriately, then we might say, well, you just should try your best not to look at it or at all. But I think we'd want to say more than that, wouldn't we? I mean, if the problem is that it's misogynistic, well, let's see to it that the industry begins to create non-misogynistic, if that's possible, porn. If the problem is that young people are exposed to it, well, let's see to it that they're not. But again, if we could fix all of these consequences of pornography, I think we'd still want to say there's something about pornography. It's not like gambling. It's not like drinking. It's something about it that's intrinsically disordered and wrong, and that's what I want to talk about. The problem when we focus solely on the consequences of pornography is we begin to think stuff like this. This is an article that came out yesterday. How much porn is too much? Now, I don't doubt that there are merits to this article, but I'd want to say any porn is too much. But if you've hung your entire hat on the fact that porn's wrong because it's addictive or causes sexual dysfunction or leads to marital breakdown, then maybe this is a legitimate question to ask. So, let's take a step back a bit before we decide whether or not pornography is intrinsically evil. And by evil, I just mean deficient in goodness, so bad. How do we know that any action is morally good or bad? Well, in order to do that, we take into account three different things. This is called the moral determinants of human acts, okay? I promise it's not as boring and philosophical. Well, it's very philosophical, but it's not as boring as it looks. I'll try to be funny. See, right then. And again. That guy's getting angry. Okay, let's continue. So, but that was good. Whenever a person does any one thing, three things are involved. There is the object, the intention, and the circumstances. The object is that thing which is chosen by the will. The intention refers to the intention of the acting subject. And the circumstances refer to the world into which that action is inserted. It has to do with the consequences of the act. All of these have to be good for the act to be good. Let me give you an example. Suppose I go outside later and I'm with one of you and we see a homeless man and I give him money. Well, that's a very good object. But suppose I do it just so you know what an amazing human being I am. Well, that's not a good thing. That's not a good intention. And even if the circumstances were good that he then went to eat that day, the action would still be in some way bad. Or let's think of a different example where the circumstances might be bad. Suppose a man makes love to his wife. It's a good object. And he does so not out of lust, but out of love. It's a good intention. But if he does so when it's medically dangerous, while he might not be culpable for that, perhaps he doesn't know of it, perhaps she doesn't know of it, I'm not sure we'd say that the act is good. So all three need to be good. But when I say something is essentially bad or intrinsically evil, what I mean is the object is wrong in and of itself and not because of external factors, right? We could think of a number of examples. Let's just give one, like killing the innocent would probably be one, right? There is no intention, however good, and no consequences that may result that could ever justify that sort of act. So is pornography wrong just because of the consequences, or is it wrong in and of itself? And that's what I think is the case. And here's why I think that. Karol Wojtyła, in his book, again, Love and Responsibility, would say that the human person is a good towards which the only proper and adequate attitude is love. Now, I think that most of us probably just accept that, even if we don't have any ontological justification for that belief. When we hold it, we don't think we're committing the error of speciesism, you know, a sort of unjustified bias in favor of Homo sapiens. It just seems like that's true. But why is it true? Well, to put that same thing negatively, we could say the person is the kind of good which does not admit of use and cannot be treated as an object of use and as such the means to an end. So let's get a little philosophical and then I promise it'll get more interesting. The universe is made up of many objects. Some of these objects are inanimate, like socks and stars and computers. And some of these objects are animate, like plants and scorpions and dogs and human beings. But among the animate objects, only we are persons. In fact, that's why the word person was coined to begin with. You see, it might be appropriate, it is appropriate and sufficient to define an animal as a single specimen of a particular animal species, but it's not adequate to define you that way. I mean, you are a single specimen of the species Homo sapien, but there's a particular richness to you that the word person brings out. You possess self-determination based on reflection. You're rational. You act from choice and not just instinct. You have free will. You can determine your own ends. Because of what the human person is, an end in himself in this sense, we can never use another person merely as a means to an end. We can make use of people, right? Like I make use of my wife because I would like children and I kind of need her to make that happen. All right, Vorna invited me here because she wanted to use me to give this talk. But we can't merely use people as means to an end. Whenever we subordinate the goodness of the human person to what other end, whatever end we're trying to attain, that's not good. And this boring philosophical reflection is borne out in our everyday experience. All of us have been used in one way or another. Yeah? And you know what that feels like when someone just uses you and you say something like, I feel taken advantage of, or it's not right that she should have done that, that he should have done that. Because of what the person is, the person's rightful due is to be treated as an object of love, not as an object of use. Right. Now, by love, now this is a word that like really has been demented in our society, right? Because I say I love Netflix and Jesus. Like, I love Stranger Things and my kids. What do we mean by love? Well, Carol Wojtyla, Thomas Aquinas before him, Aristotle, would say something like, to love another human being is to will the good of the other. It's wanting what's best for the other because of who they are. It's not that I want what's best for you for my sake. I want what's best for you for your sake. So, if I want my wife as a good, which I do, without wanting her good, this is not love. But isn't it true that pornography is very much like this? We treat people as two-dimensional objects to be consumed without recognizing them as persons to be cherished. For all of its exposure, pornography obfuscates and suppresses the personhood of the performer. I'm not interested in what she thinks. I'm not interested in her dreams or her fears or her childhood. That would get in the way. I read something recently of a porn performer, and she talked about how she was a cutter, right, when she was younger. They would cover up these scars before filming her. And I thought, what a tragic thing. I'm not interested in your pain. You're an object for my consumption. And I don't think that's okay. And I think every instance of pornography, right, of consuming pornography, right, constitutes an attitude that is contrary to the one ought to hold towards the human person. When in fact, the greater feeling of responsibility for the person, the more true love there is. Isn't that right? When you love somebody, to the degree in which you love them, don't you feel responsible for them? And yet, of course, with pornography, I'm not interested. I don't care, right? So if someone says, well, what's the problem with porn? Sex is natural. You're like, yes, sex is natural. Having an intimate encounter with your iPhone isn't, right? If you want to have natural sex, that's the problem, right? The problem is you're not doing it, you know? God invented it. Yes, he did, but you're not doing it the way he said you ought to, you know? Give all of yourself. Don't just be selfish. All right, that was rather bland. So what I'd like to do right now is play a short video clip. And this is so beautiful. Many of you have probably seen it. Kelly Clarkson singing Piece by Piece. And in this song, she talks about what it was like when she was 6 years old and her father left her and her family at the airport, just abandoned her. She said she tried to make him want her. She flew all the way over, you know, please want me, and he didn't. But then eventually, when she made something of herself, he came back. Don't you feel that grossness? He came back. Not because he loves her, right? But because he sees her as a means to an end. And watching this, I think you'll feel that pain that the human person feels when they're treated in that way. All right, so if we could dim the lights a little bit and we'll play this.
This next performer knows nothing about eliminations at all. She survived every single cut season one. She's proved to be an unstoppable force in the industry with a very emotional song called Piece by Piece. Please welcome Kelly Clarkson.
And all I remember is your back, walking towards the airport, leaving us all in your past. I traveled 1,500 miles to see you. I begged you to want me, but you didn't want to. But piece by piece, he collected me up off the ground where you abandoned things. And piece by piece, he filled the holes that you burned in me. 6 years old, and you know, he never walks away. He never asks for money. He takes care of me, 'cause he loves me. Piece by piece, he restored my faith. That a man can be kind and a father could stay. And all of your words, they fall flat. I made something of myself and now you wanna come back. But your love, it has to be earned. Back then I didn't have anything you needed, so I was worthless. Piece by piece, he collected me up off the ground where you abandoned things. Yeah, piece by piece, he filled the holes that you burned in me. 6 years old, and you know, he never walks away. He never asks for money. He takes care of me, 'cause he loves me. Piece by piece, he restored my faith. That a man can be kind and a father could stay. Piece by piece, well, piece by piece, I fell far from the tree. I will never leave her like you left me. And she will never have to wonder her worth, because unlike you, I'm gonna put her first. And you know, he'll never walk away. He'll never walk away. He'll never break her heart. He'll take care of things. He'll love her. And piece by piece, he'll restore my faith. Sorry. That a man can be kind and a father. And a father should be great. Peace by peace.
Huh. Like, unless you don't have a soul, you're crying. We were made by love, to love, and for love. Now, I know that sounds like a Hallmark thing, and so you're quick to dismiss it, but I think, whatever you think, I think it's theologically accurate. Like, I think God is love, and that we were made by love, to love, and for love, that we have love as our origin, our vocation, and our destiny. And if we don't get this right, we don't get life right. Listen to Carol Wojtyła again. He says, man cannot live without love. He remains a being that is incomprehensible for himself. His life is senseless if love is not revealed to him. If he does not encounter love, if he does not experience it and make it his own, if he does not participate intimately in it. So we were made by love, and we desire, without even trying, we can't not desire, what is true and what is good and what is beautiful. And because of this, pornography is always dissatisfying. It's exciting, and it might kind of remove me from the humdrum of daily life and give me somewhat of relief. But it's always disappointing. You know, I've never chatted with anybody who was sober who said to me, you know, I really would like to be remembered as this sort of individual, you know, a like the guy who would creep away from his wife late at night, or the lady who does this. We don't want to be thought of as this. We don't want to be these sorts of people. And what's been wonderful to see as I travel this country and internationally is there quite literally is an army of young people who are ready for a love that is untainted by selfish desires. I mean, any of you who follow the work of Fight the New Drug are aware of that. It's like if you said to these people, no, porn's okay. Look, here's a good argument. It turns out it won't hurt you. Just watch it. You're like, I don't want to. So there is a tremendous optimism that I have, and I think you should have too. I speak to about 70,000 teenagers and young adults every year, and wherever I go, they're like, finally, somebody's talking about this. If anybody's offended, it's the teachers. And they're offended because they don't think that their young people are looking at porn. And then I slap them. I'd like to close with a quotation from Professor of Literature Anthony Esselin on the human person. The human body is a precious thing, worthy of our reverence. It's not a tool, not an object of consumption like a steak or a keg of beer, not an animate provider of pleasure. It is the outward expression of a It is an outward expression of a profound mystery, that of another human being. When we meet another human person, when we look at his or her face, we are in the presence of a creature whose like we have never found in all the rest of the universe. Honor and reverence is due to the astounding mystery of the person. Listen to this. It's a contradiction to say I honor the human person while treating the human body as separable from the person, using it as a tool, devouring pornographic images of it. One cannot at once love the beautiful and desire to defile it. It's like loving the Pietà with an axe. Beautiful. So when we talk to young people, when we talk to each other, we don't have to offer hedonistic reasons that people should quit porn. You know, well, if you quit porn, you'll get your erection back. Well, that's good. You might like that if you're married, and so might your wife, right? That's a good thing. But to appeal to sort of hedonism, to fight hedonism, not only does it not work, we don't need to do it. I think instead, like our friends at Fight the New Drug are doing, we should appeal to love. This is what we desire more than anything. This is what we're seeking. When we go to pornography, it's not because we're like, well, I'm a horrible person and I'd like to exploit the human person for the next 20 minutes and then I'll go for a jog. We go because we perceive a legitimate good. We go for excitement, but we become bored. We go for intimacy, maybe. We become isolated. We go for freedom. I should be free to do whatever I want. And we become enslaved. We go for adult entertainment, and oh, the irony, we become increasingly juvenile. So, God bless you. I hope that was a help. I'd like to suggest two resources of mine that you can look into if you want to learn more. The first is my podcast. Now, if that face isn't enough to turn you off of porn, then you need to talk to Dr. Kevin Skinner. This is a podcast, and it's a weekly podcast on the effects of porn in which I interview all sorts of people, so you might want to download that. Secondly, I have a book that literally hasn't come out yet, and yet it's at this conference. They shipped a bunch of boxes here. This is a non-religious response to pro-porn arguments. I receive none of the money from these books. All of the royalties go to help a group in San Diego that help to house and bless sexually trafficked women. You should look them up. They're called Children of the Immaculate Heart. Yeah, they're doing phenomenal work. So, not that there's anything wrong with making money, but my incentive to tell you to get this isn't that. It's that it's a bloody good book. So you can get that downstairs. I also have books that I'm giving away for free downstairs, so you can learn about them there. And finally, you can learn more about what we're doing at Integrity Restored. God bless you and thanks for your time.